ASUS ROG Strix 1000 uses GaN MOSFETs instead of MOSFETs in the PSU's APFC converter for lower energy losses and increased efficiency. Nonetheless, using these FETs only doesn't necessarily increase efficiency, since you have to utilize a suitable design with the appropriate controller. As I noticed, Great Wall, the manufacturer of this PSU, uses a plain Champion CM6502 to control the APFC converter. To fully exploit GaN FETs, you must use a totem pole PFC converter, which can deliver up to 99% efficiency compared to the 96% efficiency of the most advanced conventional APFC designs, which require a compatible controller. So, I am unsure whether this Champion controller can exploit the GaN FETs. The test results will show this. The digital control Corsair AX1600i is a fine example of PSU fully exploiting GaN MOSFETs. This is a schematic of it. I also provide a schematic of a normal PSU for comparison. The big changes that GaN MOSFETs bring are PFC. Using a totem pole topology, GaN devices reduce the number of active power switches, FETs, and filtering inductors by 50%. Moreover, a significant increase in switching frequency, which can reach up to tenfold, significantly reduces the size of magnetics while improving overall efficiency to over 99% versus 96% of today's titanium class power supplies. LLC resonant converter. The DC-DC stage uses GaN's superior switching characteristics to increase the resonant converter switching frequencies to over 1 MHz. This frequency reduces transformer size while improving power density and efficiency. This is why GaN devices can have ultra-compact dimensions. Point of load, DC-DC, GaN significantly impacts those converters. First, it enables a single-step conversion from 36 to 60 volt to power the PC parts, reducing the number of components needed and enabling smaller dimension PSUs. Additionally, the smaller footprint of a GaN-based solution allows engineers and designers to easily stack the power stages for different load demands and place them close to the load for better and faster transient performance. This means there is no need for multiple rail outputs, 12V, 5V and 3.3V, which currently impose a two-step conversion. The individual components can generate all required voltages from a single voltage output. Nowadays, most components have their own DC-DC converters, but they don't all use the same voltage. With GaN-based solutions, those components can generate the needed rails from a single higher voltage rail without increased losses, all while using fewer components in a more compact chassis. However, for such a significant change to take effect, the manufacturers of GPUs, mainboards, and other parts will have to cooperate with the PSU designers. This is something that the Intel ATX version 12V only spec tried to achieve, with no success so far. The PSU only outputs 12V and 12V VSB, and the parts are responsible for adjusting this voltage to their needs. With the use of GaN MOSFETs, the required DC-DC converter circuits can be tiny in size so that they won't affect the form factor of these parts. The box has a photo of the PSU on its face and some certification badges, including the Cybernetics noise rating. For unknown reasons, ASUS only uses the Cybernetics noise badge, not the efficiency one. The PSU has an interesting exterior design with a nicely designed fan grille with large perforations to restrict the fan's airflow as little as possible. On the front side, besides the AC receptacle and the power switch, there is an additional switch for toggling on or off the PSU's semi-passive fan operation. Around the back, the modular board holds an extra proprietary socket next to the 12V 2x6 one, providing two extra sense pins. ASUS claims the extra sense pins help achieve tighter load regulation on the 12+4 pin connector. The provided cables and connectors are sufficient for a modern 1000 watt unit, including 2PS, 4PCI Express on dedicated cables, a single 12V 2x6 set at 600 watt, 6 SATA and 3 4-pin Molex connectors. All cables are long, with the EPS cables reaching 1 meter ensuring compatibility with whatever chassis you use. The distance between the 4-pin Molex connectors is adequate at 150 mm, but the distance between the SATA connectors is short. Lastly, all cables are individually sleeved. The design is clean with lots of clear space on the secondary side for unobstructed airflow. The primary side heatsinks are large, helping lower the fan speed and noise output. The only daughter board holds the DC-DC converters that generate the minor rails. The design might be clean, but unfortunately it is not as modern as I expected given the MOSFETs on the APFC converter. For starters, Great Wall didn't use a bridgeless totem pole APFC converter, which offers minimized energy losses and the highest possible efficiency, but a plain CCM one. Given the standard PFC controller, I believe that using MOSFETs in this PSU helps more in marketing than in real life performance. Overall, the build quality is good, with spotless soldering jobs and good pads used, but the PCB's backside protection coating should be cleaner. It will not affect performance, but I couldn't help but notice it. That said, it is good to see proper thermal pads used in the PSU's FETs and a special heatsink along with thermal paste for the MOSFETs, but if they wanted to do a perfect job, they should avoid using plain screws, but ones with clips. On the primary side, in addition to the typical APFC converter, we find a half-bridge topology and an LLC resonant converter. A synchronous rectification scheme on the secondary side regulates the 12-volt rail through 6 Infineon FETs, and 2 DC-DC controllers handle the minor rails. All filtering caps are by well-known brands, and Great Wall used several electrolytic caps to provide enough capacity for the PSU to withstand transient load. The cooling fan uses a double ball bearing, which is much more tolerant to high operating temperatures, but also has increased bearing noise at lower RPMs. Fluid dynamic bearings do not face this issue, while providing an equally long lifetime under normal operating conditions. Given that a PSU fan most likely won't have to operate under harsh conditions, and because of the double ball bearing noise, FTP fans dominate the PSU market. Here are some sample audio clips from the fan's noise at various speeds for you to see the bearing noise I'm talking about. The 12-volt rails OCPT giving points are set low and differ enough between cold and hot conditions, so everything is good here. On the other hand, the minor rails have sky-high OCPT giving points, and to make matters worse, the differences between cold and high temperatures are minimal. The OCP triggering points should be notably lower under high temperatures to provide more effective protection. The overpower protection is set correctly, and the other major protection features are present, but fan failure, which should be provided in this high-end PSU. Load regulation is within 1% on all major rails but 3.3 volt. Ripple suppression is good overall. The transient response is good at 12 volt and 5 volt, and the deviation is not that high at 3.3 volt, but still, this rail drops below 3.2 volt the moment the transient load is applied. The PSU passes all ATX version 3.1 transient response tests, but the 12-volt rail drops low in the 200% load test. The 12-volt rail's performance could be better in general. Efficiency is high at normal loads and light loads with 150 volt input. It is high enough at light loads and 230 volt input, and satisfactory with a 2% load. The unit's average efficiency is high enough, but it doesn't take the lead from other high-end platforms that don't use GaN FETs in the APFC converter, primarily at 230 volt. This proves my point that the GaN FETs are used mainly for marketing, since the PSU's design doesn't exploit them. The APFC converter has decent performance. The 5SB rail is highly efficient, Vampire Power is increased. The PSU's average noise output is low, but this graph doesn't depict the whole truth. So, I had to run a frequency analysis in this unit. The fan stop feature is active at up to around 560 watts, so the PSU's output noise is minimal. Between 560 watt and 630 watt, noise is within 6 to 10 decibels, and from 505 watt to 825 watt, noise is within 15 to 20 decibels. The noisiest operation looks like a rocket in the fan noise map, and it is from 885 to 920 watt, with the output noise between 25 to 30 decibels. In no case did the PSU's noise exceed the 30 decibels mark. The fan stop feature is active up to around 570 watt. Between 570 watt and 650 watt, noise is within 6 to 10 decibels. And from 730 watt to 855 watt, noise is within 15 to 20 decibels. With more than 855 watt loads, noise is in the 20 to 25 decibels range. The overall performance is high enough, with over 1% differences with the FSP Hydro TI Pro, Superflower Lidex XP and NGXT C1000. I don't have any MSRP information on the ASUS ROG Strix 1000 Watt Platinum, which would help me determine if the lack of a totem pole APFC converter is justified. If the MSRP is high, Great Wall, the OEM of this unit, would have the required headroom to provide a more advanced design and not a plain one, with the only difference with the competition that it uses GaN MOSFETs, whose unique features are not exploited. Without having the appropriate design and controller, there is no point in using GaN MOSFETs, since you cannot increase the switching frequencies high enough to make a real difference from the other platforms using plain MOSFETs. A clear example of a PSU fully exploiting the GaN MOSFETs is the Corsair AX1600i, which, although it is aged, still is among the best performing PSUs in today's market, with its only downside the lack of ATX version 3.1 compliance. The ASUS ROG Strix 1000 Watt Platinum achieves a high enough overall performance, is efficient and has a low overall noise output. Still, if you look at the corresponding cybernetics report, you will notice a mention of the fan bearing noise at low fan speeds. The bearing noise might be low regarding decibels, but it is still annoying. This is why I conducted extended noise measurements in this unit, including a frequency analysis. Double ball bearing fans might have many advantages, but have a crucial disadvantage: the bearing noise at low speeds. This is why most brands avoid using them in PSUs where the fan has to spin at low speeds under light loads, and in most systems, PSUs operate in such conditions. ASUS informed me that they would change the fan to another brand, but still to a double ball bearing model. So, until I get a new sample, I cannot be sure whether the terrible fan bearing noise at low speeds will be fixed. Before investing in a new power supply, read my best ATX version 3.x PSUs article on hwbusters.com to check all alternative PSU offerings. You will also find this product's review on the same site. Bye bye.